Our goal is today is to frankly just to give a sense to the public. We've got many experts here today as well, just to talk about where we're at on Zika. I've been very focused early on. It wasn't something for me from a political standpoint. It was just trying to do the right thing. I've talked to enough folks in terms of the funding, and I think it's important that we make sure we've got adequate resources. But we're going to have a time to discuss that and then open it up for the public if they've got a few questions. But let's start off with Dr. Redd, please.
Thanks, Congressman Buchanan. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here today and talk with everybody. I'm looking forward to hearing from the other panel members. This actually is quite a distinguished panel, and I want to thank everybody for coming today. This Zika emergency was unforeseeable, and I'll talk a little bit about the history of the virus and how we came to where we are today. It's also a very complicated problem, and Dr. Frieden, the CDC director, whenever he talks about Zika, says that it's the most complex emergency that he's ever dealt with. Almost every part of CDC and of public health around the country is working on this response. The one group that isn't participating is the Injury Control Center. And if you think about all the different parts of public health, from viral diseases, diagnostic technology, pregnancy, birth defects, vectors, all of those groups are participating in the response. The third main point is that we are learning a lot every day. Because this problem emerged suddenly and was unforeseen, we continue to learn, and it's going to be very important that as we implement measures to prevent infection and prevent these severe birth defects that are being seen, that we continue to refine our interventions. What I'd like to do now is talk about the history of the problem, and then what we're doing to address it. The Zika virus was discovered in 1947. It was actually part of a project that the Rockefeller University funded in Uganda, in the Zika forest, hence the name Zika. They put monkeys out to really kind of the canary in the coal mine, and identified this virus in a macaque monkey that had become infected. Over the next few years, there were a handful of human cases, but there was a 50-year period when no Zika virus infections were identified. In the mid-2000s, outbreaks of the virus transmitted by mosquitoes were detected in the Pacific. The investigations at that point determined that, for the most part, the virus caused a mild infection. In fact, the majority of infections didn't even cause symptoms. There was a high rate of infection in the population, but really not thought to be a very serious problem. In the spring of 2015, the virus was identified in Brazil, was causing outbreaks there, and the initial word was pretty much like it was in the Pacific. Outbreaks, but not a severe disease. Most people don't seem to be, don't even have symptoms. The symptoms when they do occur are skin rash, conjunctivitis, mild fever, joint aches. And that was the situation up until November of 2015. And at that point, from Brazil, there are reports about microcephaly, high rates of microcephaly being detected. So that just means small head, small brain. I have to say that the initial sense from those reports was one of skepticism, that there had never been a mosquito-borne disease that caused a specific birth defect. It had been 50 years since a viral infection had been identified as a cause of birth defects. There were some questions about the measurement of the size of the head, and maybe there were some problems with that. I'd have to say that that skepticism has been replaced with quite a bit of concern. At CDC in January, we obtained brain specimens from fetuses and babies that had died of the infection. Under the microscope, you can see the virus infecting the brain. It's there, and it causes not just problems of development, but actual destruction of the brain tissue. It turns out that the type of microcephaly that Zika virus causes is very specific, and in fact, the brain almost collapses, and that leads to the small head, not just a small brain, but actually a collapse of the skull as the brain is destroyed. A very severe birth defect. The last thing, I think it's obvious, but the problem is actually here already. Not in mosquito-borne transmission, but in travelers that have returned from parts of the world that have this infection. We are actually up to almost 700 travel-associated cases in the United States. The most recent information is that 132 of those are in Florida. Florida's pretty close to the places that are having this virus transmission, so it's natural that there would be more infections here. We've also seen sexual transmission of the virus. We were talking earlier, after the first handful of traveler-associated cases had been identified in the U.S., there was a report from Dallas of a case of sexual transmission. This was certainly not expected, and is really a wild card into how the virus can be transmitted, and it actually brings up a whole different set of interventions that are needed. So today, the problem in the U.S. is really a potential problem other than travel-associated cases and the sexual transmission cases. We don't have documented mosquito transmission here, but we do have the vectors, and particularly in Florida, and the risk is that a returning traveler would actually infect a mosquito that could then infect people, and that would be the way that the virus the way that mosquito transmission would occur. So what we are doing to prevent this problem, which I should mention also, it's not a potential problem in Puerto Rico, in the Virgin Islands, and in the Pacific territories where there's widespread transmission, particularly in Puerto Rico. What we are doing is, first of all, and this is probably the main message of everything we need to do about Zika, is protect pregnant women. That there are individual measures of protection. Shortly after that work was done to identify the virus in the brains of fetuses, CDC issued travel advisories to countries that had documented transmission that if you're pregnant, you really shouldn't be going to one of these countries. If you're thinking about becoming pregnant, you probably shouldn't go. People don't instantly know that they're pregnant, so that risk of becoming infected while pregnant is really the risk. We are also working hard, particularly in Puerto Rico, to control transmission, and that is especially on the vector. The mosquito that transmits this virus, the Aedes aegypti mosquito, is prevalent in many parts of the country. It's very prevalent in Puerto Rico. It's very difficult to control effectively. There are a series of interventions from getting rid of breeding sites, using larvicides that kill the immature forms of the mosquito, and using different methods to kill adult mosquitoes that are the ones that would be transmitting the virus. And I think that I'm looking forward especially to hearing from our colleagues here in Florida, where there's long experience in vector control. In fact, we've set up an interaction between the officials in Puerto Rico and Manatee County, particularly, to try to transmit some of that knowledge to Puerto Rico. So we've got the Protect Pregnant Women working on vector control. This is also a time for, I think not so much in the United States where we don't have the vector being transmitted, but for people who are living in areas that have mosquito transmission, so that's Puerto Rico, the Virgin Islands, the Pacific Territories, to think about whether, if you don't want to become pregnant, there are things that you can do to prevent that, and that will certainly prevent the birth defects. Let me just close by saying we really don't know what the future is going to hold for this virus. Our best models are dengue and chikungunya. These are viruses that have been spread through South and Central America. We have large numbers of travel-associated cases. We've had isolated cases of mosquito-borne transmission. That's the most likely case in the United States. Now, those viruses cause fairly severe diseases, but don't have the birth defects consequences that Zika virus has. So we are working very hard collectively to respond to those isolated cases of mosquito-borne transmission, which we can't say for sure that they'll happen, but certainly is a possibility, and make sure that that first case, we implement control measures to prevent a wider outbreak. I think we do have a lot to learn. There's a lot we need to do to make sure that we don't have more problems than we already have in Puerto Rico, and that we can take the steps necessary that when those isolated cases within the U.S. occur, that we're ready to respond on all fronts. So thanks very much.
Thank you. Let me just also suggest the mindset in dealing with a lot of experts. Everybody's pretty much told me the same thing. In terms of the U.S., we're ground zero, potentially Florida. And the idea is make sure they've got adequate funding. That's why I support the president's proposal on the funding. And make sure that, again, if we don't need the funding like Ebola, there was $600 million that we didn't need, then they can be used, redeployed. But the fact of the matter is, I think the Admiral mentioned 130 cases maybe here in Florida. Puerto Rico's got 1,500, a lot in South America. You can begin to put a number on that. We're the gateway. They come into Miami, Orlando, Tampa, and that's why we've got to be very concerned. So the key thing here is not to over-alarm anybody, but we want to prevent from anything happening. So with this, what I'd like to do is give our panelists a couple of minutes each, and if they could take a minute to introduce themselves, and I'll mention the names, Dr. Washington Hill, maybe we could let you lead off, sir.
Good morning. I'm Washington Hill, and I'm OBGYN. Next time you see Denise Jamison, tell her I said hello. Does she ever get any sleep? I really appreciate your comments in regards to pregnant women. This is the first disease of any where a mosquito has caused a birth defect. Mosquitoes have caused other things, like malaria, but not a birth defect. So what we've been trying to do, and with the health department, CDC, ACOG, and others, is certainly to tell pregnant women that if you are pregnant, that you should not go to the areas that are involved. And I remember I saw a patient in the health department, and she'd missed a couple appointments. And I say, so where have you been? We need you to come in. And she said, I went to Brazil to see grandma. And I told her, this is not the time to go to see grandma. Now we have flyers and posters in the clinic rooms, and nurses and doctors who can tell them not to go to these affected areas. If you're pregnant, unfortunately, you can't go to the Olympics. If you send your husband to the Olympics, that creates another problem, because when husband returns, they like to have sex. And we don't know how long if the husband is infected. So we advise, and CDC suggestion is not to have sex at all. So our real concern is to protect women who are pregnant from the virus, to use appropriate mosquito precautions. There was some concern some years ago about DEET, but we know that DEET is safe to use. So I'll leave it at that and wait for any questions. Thank you.
Next, I'd like to introduce Chuck Henry, Sarasota County Health Department Administrator. Chuck?
Good morning, and thank you. And I'll just speak briefly about preparation and prevention activities in Sarasota County. Early in February, when things began to really look serious, we established an incident management team that included our mosquito control, our emergency management team at the county level, and a number of clinicians, and they've been meeting initially weekly and now as needed to evaluate new data as CDC publishes data, keep an eye on what's going on, and establish a communication with that team. And I think for us, that's the most important thing, is understanding as a community where the risks are, what resources we need, and to continue to work towards that. We freely share necessary information. For example, if we have someone that's been identified and being tested for Zika, and so far in Sarasota, we've not had even a traveler case identified, but we've tested a number of folks. And so anytime we do that, we identify where they're at, we make sure that they have the right education, we make sure our mosquito folks know where they're at so that they can do surveillance in that area. We're trying to really work hard to stay ahead of the game and keep abreast of all the latest information.
Thanks, Chuck, and that's really my goal. You touched on it. Make sure you have the resources in Sarasota, Manatee County, to do what you need to do. Jennifer Bensey, Manatee County Health Department Administrator. Jennifer?
Good morning. Admiral, thank you so much for joining us on behalf of the Florida Department of Health. We look forward to working with you here. And Congressman, thank you for organizing this important event. Just to give you the background, and I'm sure you're familiar with many of the players, your peers who were with us since September 11th, we developed the Regional Domestic Security Task Forces in Florida, following the Florida Department of Law Enforcement regions, if you will. And so we've taken an all-hazards approach to any type of disaster that may come our way. The hurricanes of 04, 05 were one example. Obviously, what happened yesterday, a mass casualty incident, bringing to the forefront that anything can happen. Zika is another example of that type of event. But I'm proud to say that Florida has been developing this system for 15 years now, and we work together extremely well. I'm so proud of the first responders and the first receivers in the Central Florida region who have been tremendous in the last 24 hours responding to the event. And we have the same type of activities here in terms of exercises, trainings, development of protocols. The Florida Department of Health actually has asked under the governor's original executive order regarding Zika back in February to make sure that we meet with all of our partners, which we have done in our communities to make sure we are prepared. And now we'll be doing a tabletop exercise in the next few weeks as well in every county in Florida relating to Zika again to make sure that everyone is involved. The medical community has done a tremendous amount of work with us, making sure that they know those chains of communication, getting that information to us. The laboratories now, LabCorp and Quest, are now available to do testing. Still working with the state laboratories to assure confirmation of any of those Zika cases in our state. So we feel prepared, but we are so glad that you're here with us and that CDC has been so helpful. And obviously the work of you, Congressman, in getting those funds to us so that we can do these activities with our partners to make sure we're ready for anything that comes our way and protect our community. Thank you.
Thanks. Don, the director of Manatee County Emergency Management, if you want to give us a little couple of minute update.
Sure. Well, thank you. I have a team that supports the Emergency Operations Center. As Dr. Bensey mentioned, we focus on an all-hazard approach, and there will be an exercise coming up we're very much looking forward to. Our focus is really to maintain the Emergency Operations Center and support all the medical and community partners, including the Florida Department of Health in Manatee County. Thank you very much for doing what you're doing here today.
Thanks. And then on the prevention side, Matt Smith, Sarasota County Mosquito Control District. I know you've got a big job, too.
Good morning. Thanks for having me. First, I would like to say that as far as mosquito control goes, we are very well equipped to handle not only Zika, but dengue and chikungunya. They're very closely related. They exploit the same species of mosquitoes that we do have in this area as vectors or transmitter agents. And there's also a lot of really good mosquito control in the state of Florida. We pass a lot of information around through the Florida Mosquito Control Association. And it's been really nice to see the level that this has come to and that funding is being made available. We at our district personally are applying for a little bit of funding, mostly for lab upgrades because we're in the process of developing our own tests for Zika in mosquitoes so we can determine if mosquitoes in our area are affected very fast and very efficiently in a very sensitive manner. One thing I would say, though, that I think gets a little left out sometimes is the fact that there's a huge public component to this. Because these mosquitoes that we deal with have specific requirements for where they breed. They breed in hidden, cryptic sites. They have very short flight ranges, so they tend to be found very close, within several hundred feet to a few, couple hundred yards from the place where they breed. And they like to breed in the artificial containers and junk in the backyard and even bromeliad plants. So one of the biggest tools that we could have in to aid us in the fight against Zika and dengue and chikungunya is public awareness. Getting that message out that everyone, that if everyone would actually spend time on a regular basis checking their own property for anything holding water and anything that they don't know about or they're unsure about, if they would call mosquito control professionals, we could drastically reduce the threat of Zika just through some public awareness.
Thanks, Matt. Mark, from the director of Manatee County Mosquito Control.
Yes, thank you for the invite. I've been working in mosquito control for 36 years now, and each of the three programs that I've worked with have been heavily involved with Aedes aegypti control. And one of the disappointing things is the fact that public awareness, public education doesn't seem to be working. And I don't know what more we can do to enlighten the public that this is a very important issue. And that
by the way, why do you say that? Why do you say that it doesn't seem? Because there's a lot out there on infection and everything, disease. What's your thought? Why do you say that?
My thought is, you know, we respond to the public, and my inspectors will go yard to yard, you know, go backyards to find out if it's an urban area where the problems are coming from. And invariably, we'll go back to the same locations, and it'll be the same containers and the same issues. It's like you go and tell the public what needs doing, and they listen to you for that 5 minutes you're there, and then there's something more important they have to get on to, and it's gone. We have a public education specialist who works with the elementary schools, because it seems that's a route which seems to have some effect, because the kids are so interested and they'll go back and they'll shame their parents into cleaning up the backyard. So that seems to work rather well. Echoing what Matt says, that this very much is something we need the public's help. we cannot be proactive apart from public education. We can only be reactive. And in Manatee County for the last 6 years, we have actually been doing research on looking at what methods work. Obviously, the methods we use, which tend to be larvaciding and adulticiding, are temporary measures. Unless you get rid of the breeding source, it's going to come back again. But we know that we can react when we're informed by the health department, and we have a very good relationship with the health department, that we can react very quickly to the location where there is an imported case to make sure we eliminate any potential for local transmission to occur.
Let's just finish with the doctor, a USF professor, and works in the health department. Doctor, was there anything you'd like to add?
Not much. I agree with Mark that one of the things that we're facing at this point is the unwillingness of the public actually to move ahead and remove the breeding sites. One of the most effective programs actually forever controlling Aedes aegypti was about 25 years ago in Puerto Rico, when the Boy Scouts introduced a merit badge in entomology and mosquito control. And that turned out to dramatically reduce the numbers of Aedes aegypti because you had a bunch of 11 and 12-year-old boys running around shaming their parents and emptying out the containers in their backyards and all throughout their neighborhoods. So there are ways of getting at this, but it turns out to be a rather intractable problem. I'd just like to say there's a lot that we don't know about this virus and a lot that we don't know about the pathology and the pathogenesis of the virus. Still moving forward, that I think it's really important that we need to accelerate research on this area and also in terms of development of new modalities for treatment. I think primarily vaccination will turn out to be a very effective route to go. Zika virus is a flavivirus, which is closely related to yellow fever virus, which has been historically the most effective vaccine that's been ever developed in history. So chances are that we will be able to develop a vaccine for this, and I think this is going to end up being a rather short-term problem once there is a vaccine out there and improved diagnostics. But there really is a need for us to really understand exactly what's going on here. In terms of the pathogenesis, when women are particularly at risk for developing this? Is it all throughout pregnancy or just during certain times of pregnancy? Exactly what's driving the whole pathogenesis? Is there anything we can do to identify the problems early and perhaps contraindicate them as they move along? So there's many things that we don't know and many things that we really could use assistance to actually figure out to help control this along the way.
Well, let me just say before we open it up to the public, first to the panelists, I want to thank all of you. But while we got the Admiral here from CDC, came down from Atlanta, what more, because we're going to get the resources one way or the other, I feel confident about that. What is it that they can best do to help us locally here in this region or in Florida? And I'd ask any of you what needs you might have or your thoughts on that question. Matt, go ahead.
Thank you. Well, I mean, definitely streamlining any sort of funding efforts is a must because the problem we're facing now is people are traveling. The Olympics are right around the corner, so funding 6, 8, 9 months down the road is going to be a little after the fact for a lot of districts. Some need more than others. Like I said, we're only seeking a very tiny amount. It's mostly to develop our lab a little further so we can finalize our own testing procedures for Zika. But another one would be, I think, a major unified media campaign. Public opinion follows the media. And if you have, like yourself, public officials at the highest level reminding people to check their yard, things like that, you're not going to get everybody, but at least you're going to increase the numbers of people that think about it. Because right now, Zika is in a lot of people's minds. It has a bit of a fear factor to it because of the strange nature of it with the microcephaly and the sexual transmission. So I believe if we did have more people uniformly and constantly pushing out that message that the public can help prevent this themselves more than anything else, kind of get some public buy-in to it on a national and unified level, that would be very helpful. Thank you.
Let me also add, maybe you can address that, because some people have asked me, there are people from this area going to the Olympics. What's your thoughts on that? I mean, because obviously it's a big issue in that part of the world.
Sure. The Olympics are certainly a topic of a lot of discussion within CDC and within the executive department. So the first thing is that based on dengue transmission, it's fortunate that it's going to be winter in Brazil during the time of the Olympics. So there should be less transmission than there is at other times of year, and that's what is seen in dengue. The other big point is really the same advice that we give to go to other areas that have Zika virus transmission, which is if you're pregnant or considering becoming pregnant, really need to think hard about whether that's the right trip to take, and probably isn't. Now there are some more sort of lower level questions about if a person has symptoms, how do we make sure that they get tested, those kinds of things, or other areas that we're working in right now. But the main message is the same as it is for travel to other Zika affected areas, that there's a risk if you're pregnant or thinking about becoming pregnant. And then the same point about men who are having sex with people who are in that same reproductive age group.
And I guess the other question Matt kind of asked, is there going to be any funding part of this campaign, or do you know about messaging or getting kind of informing the public? Because you don't want to alarm them, but at the same time, you want them to have be equipped and in terms of prevention. I'm big on prevention. I don't want to see it become a problem. So that's why I think it's something we need to get on. But do you know if there's going to be some funding to be able to communicate?
There would be. And I think that's almost something that you can almost define an emergency by the need to communicate and the knowledge deficit that is really heightens concerns about people who really don't have information. And so that would be a big part and needs to be a big part of our response.
I think the problem is it's just not information. A lot of times there's misinformation, so you don't want to have people too alarmed, but the same thing. Doctor, do you have something you want to add?
I think you need to keep doing what you're doing. I think providing information to clinicians, healthcare providers, there's 300 doctors here in OBGYNs here in Florida, and they look to CDC and ACOG to provide information, which then they can pass on to their patients. I think the information in Florida obviously needs to be bilingual or trilingual because we have a very mixed population, so that they will get the information without being, as the Congressman said, without scaring them. But bilingual, Haitian, Spanish, et cetera, I think is very important.
And I think the bottom line, what you're saying right now, if you're contemplating traveling, or maybe having a baby or something in these countries, you got to be the extra sensitive. I think that's the bottom line right now.
Absolutely. There's a lot of aspects to this, but fundamentally, this is about preventing birth defects and protecting pregnant women. And the other aspects of that all kind of revolve around that central idea.
Okay. Any of the other panelists? Jennifer?
Yes. We have in Florida the Zika virus hotline. It's run with poison control. It's 24/7. But I know the CDC also has a hotline. Is that for the U.S. as well as the Caribbean? And how can we partner on that initiative?
So we have a couple of different systems. One is the basic CDC info. That's actually those numbers that match up on the telephone. We have a clinician hotline as well that can be routed through either the operations center or the CDC info. And let me get back to you on how we could make sure. I think the worst thing, just to go back to communications, we have to be really sure we're always saying the same thing. And that is difficult as information changes, that we could both be saying something that was true, but if it's true at different points in time, it might not be the same. And so we need to work hard to make sure that we stay synchronized.
It seems to me that you guys have to take the lead on that. You can't have because we have 67 counties in Florida. Everybody has. Mark?
Yeah, I think one thing that the CDC can help with, and it's not so much in our area, but in a lot of parts of the country, the use of pesticides to control mosquitoes, while we accept that it is a method of last resort, it is a method you need to use when you're going against a disease vector. Here, the public is very accepting of what we do, understanding, Florida is full of mosquitoes, so we can do our aerial spraying, truck spraying, whatever, without too much problem. But you go to other parts of the country where this is not normally done, but then if you did have some local transmission going on, a good example of where this all went wrong was Dallas, where they had a major outbreak of West Nile a few years back. And it took till the end of the disease cycle, when it's actually on its way down, before the local politicians, who had so much pressure from the anti-pesticide people, would even agree to do anything. And I think the CDC can help, because they are a trusted health organization, you know, within the country, and they can provide this information that will be listened to by the public.
Let me ask just along a little bit different, but I get people ask, what is a mosquito? I mean, the idea of no-see-ems, we get that all over Florida, but we get them here. I mean, do you have any sense that maybe these guys know quite a bit about the whole mosquito, what a mosquito is and what it isn't, I can't answer that question. Who might be the carrier in terms of mosquito? I don't know.
Well,
Well, what is a mosquito? It is a name given to a...
There's a lot of things flying around out there. I'm just...
It's a type of fly. It's particular, belongs to the genus Julesidae. There are many different species. The ones that transmit Zika, there's only believed to be two species that transmit Zika of the 45 to 50 species we actually have in our counties. So it's only, you know, within mosquitoes there is a whole bunch of different species.
Yeah, that's what people have been asking me. I'm just trying to get a sense of that.
And we're going to, what people are going to see this week, after the 10 inches of rain we got last week, a bunch of mosquitoes out there. And what I try to explain to people is, well, if you live in the rural areas and you live close to coastal swamps or out in the eastern parts of the county, those terrible mosquitoes you're seeing are not disease vectors. They are nuisance mosquitoes. The disease vectors that transmit Zika are only found in association with man in urban areas, urban, suburban areas. So trying to get that message across so people aren't panicking about all those mosquitoes they're seeing coming off from the
That's a good message to get out there. Anything else from the panel? Chuck?
First off, I just want to, again, thank you for putting this forum together. Obviously, from a public health perspective, this is one of our most important issues across Florida. And in terms of what the CDC could continue to do, helping develop that message for the public and processes to inform the public without panicking them on how do we deal with travelers, what's the best method to ensure as people return from traveling that they connect with the public health system and get the right information to the right people. I think we're uniquely positioned in Florida because we have an integrated statewide health system for public health. So while there's 67 counties, we're all connected and we share resources probably better than many states. So that would be it.
Thanks. Okay, with that, I'd like to just take a minute. If any of the public would has a question of any of our panelists or of the Admiral, I'd like to open it up. Yes, sir.
I'm Craig LaFay.
We're going to grab a mic here so you get a chance. But anybody can ask a question as it relates to Zika primarily today.
I'm Craig LaFay. I'm a research professor up at the Prevention Research Center at USF and also at RTI International. And my colleagues and I are doing work in Puerto Rico on Zika right now with the CDC Foundation. We're in Guatemala. And I also have spent most of my career doing communications and marketing work. So I'd like to kind of throw in a different point of view on this idea of a single message. And that is that you're really going to need to think about how you're going to craft messages for different groups of people. It is not about a message. If the message worked, a woman would not have visited her grandmom in Brazil. But that woman didn't hear the message that she needed to hear. So as we're thinking about public communication, and I completely agree that's the place to start, yes, there is a concern about raising fear. But telling people what they need to do, to go back to that point, I think was a great point about how do you get people out there to actually stop the breeding areas. When you look at what's going on in Brazil and Puerto Rico and the public education methods that are going on down there, as much of it is about how do you activate the community and your neighborhoods to get involved in this as it is to simply say go out and get some DEET and wear long sleeve shirts and long pants. So I just like to kind of throw that into the mix here as we're thinking about things. In terms of resources, I get real concerned, and I kind of heard it, but I didn't hear it clearly. This rapid identification of Zika, whether it's from the mosquito or whether it's from a patient, resources that are needed to do that effectively quickly are really important because I think, as you've said, the travel cases are going to start multiplying, and we need to be ready to quickly identify what's going on there and not be waiting until the end of a cycle to launch a response.
Now, let me just respond to that. Personally, I'm pushing for resources yesterday. The $1.9 billion is the number we're looking at. If we don't need it, we won't spend it. But I think as we're coming into Florida summers and mosquitoes, I think we need to get those funds quickly. I think we're moving in that direction. Unfortunately, it is Washington. It does take a little bit longer. But I think it's going to be sooner than later that we'll have the funding numbers. The House was at $600 million. The Senate was at $1.1 billion. But there's another 600 million from Ebola. So I think we'll get to the Senate version plus that. So it gets pretty close to the president's request of $1.9 billion. So I think we're well on our way, but I'm pushing personally to get it done sooner or later. And as I mentioned maybe a little bit earlier, the reality of it is I've talked to a lot of scientists, people at CDC. They've convinced me that it's real. So this shouldn't be about politics. It should be about getting the resources, because it's about public safety and prevention. And that's really the goal that we're trying to put in place. And that's why we're having this forum even today, is just to open it up a little bit to the public. Did you want to add anything to that? Okay. Yes, sir. Doctor from USF.
Dr. Ricardo Zubieta from University of South Florida. I just would like to make a very quick commentary. There are some areas in which we don't know too much about the virus, as the Admiral has mentioned, and we have to do research on that. So we need resources to know some specific areas of the transmission of the virus, to give to the public the right information. That's the only commentary that I will make. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Yes, sir.
I realize that the onus of prevention to be placed on the public is a kind of a difficult thing to do. In my own community, one third of the people aren't even in their residence. They're up north someplace. And so their yards are not kept up at all. Is aerial spraying more effective, on a broad base program? I know when I first moved here 20 years ago, I'd hear the planes go over 3 or 4 times a season, and sometimes I thought they were going to come right into my living room. I haven't heard them at all this year. I know that something to the tune of $25,000 per aerial spraying. Is that too excessive, that we can't do more of that?
Yeah, and I would just add, I've read stuff, like, and I'm sure different parts of the state, maybe they do it differently, but I just noticed down, I read something in the Florida Keys where the planes are flying over 6 times and maybe they go 10 times, I don't know. But any thoughts that Mark or Matt, you guys have in terms of this area and just in terms of spraying in general?
Well, aerial spraying or any form of adult sighting is a temporary measure. So that the way that we use it is when we have excessive mosquito populations and it warrants the use of it, then we will use aerial spraying. And that's what's going to happen this week in light of the flooding rains from last week.
And by the way, where will you spray? Let's take a look at Manatee County, for example. You're with Manatee County. Where are you going to spray?
Spray where the highest mosquito populations are. And what our very simple philosophy is, when we're dealing with, not with Zika mosquitoes, but with our normal nuisance mosquitoes, which come out of flooded swamps and pastures and whatever else, after the heavy rain, the first thing we do is we go out to the areas which we know produce these mosquitoes, and we aerially spray with a larvicide, which is a biological product that is specific solely to mosquitoes. It has to be digested by the mosquito larvae for it to work. So we concentrate our efforts around the main population centers, the urban centers, where we know we can have good effect with that, which will limit the need to do any adult siding. When we start getting into the more rural areas where it's a lower population and aerial larva siding just won't work because the areas are too vast when you look at the flooded pastures and whatever out east, then we resign ourselves to the fact that we're going to have to wait till they turn to adult mosquitoes and then hit them as adult mosquitoes, because adult siding is, you can hit far larger areas than you can with larva siding. I mean, we can do 50 square miles in a night, whereas with larva siding, you might be able to do 1 square mile. That's the method that we choose, why we do it.
Just switching gears a little bit, also just to look at Florida, we don't have, of the 130 cases, those are cases that have been identified from people traveling either back to Florida, so it's not as though we've found mosquitoes yet in that position, just to be candid,
that's
clear
absolutely
about
correct,
it.
That we have returning travelers who have been diagnosed as having infection and they acquired that infection outside of Florida. The risk.
It's not as if we've found any mosquitoes anywhere in Florida at this point.
That's correct. That's correct.
That are infected.
And the way that would be likely to play out is a person would be diagnosed, the investigation would yield that they hadn't traveled, that they didn't have a sexual partner who had traveled, and so it would be a sort of a process of exclusion.
But then when you think about Puerto Rico, for example, they've been infected down there by the mosquitoes, is that the idea?
That's correct, and it started the same way a traveler from another location returned to Puerto Rico, and because the vector is widespread there, that cycle of mosquito biting an infected person, incubating the virus, and then biting another person, that's how that happened. And that's same thing with dengue and chikungunya. But there is widespread mosquito transmission in Puerto Rico right now.
And then let me ask you, I know we haven't decided the funding number yet, but we're getting closer. What is CDC doing right now in terms of dealing with it? Because you know you're going to be somewhere, my sense, you know, $1.2 billion and $1.9 billion, which I think will be at the $1.9 billion number. But what are you guys doing as an organization right now to address the concern?
Sure. Well, there we have reprogrammed funding already within the budget to fight this problem because, as you've said, we can't wait. There's intensive work taking place in Puerto Rico to control the vector, to protect pregnant women with information and with individual measures to prevent infection. We have developed diagnostic tests, actually two different kinds of tests, one that identifies the virus, another that identifies the body's response to the virus. So the virus can only be detected for a few days, but if that that person's been infected, there'll be an antibody test to measure the body's response. So two different tests have been developed. Those have been disseminated. Travel advice, I think not enough information, but what we could do within the available funds and really intensive planning, particularly with the locations that are at heightened risk. There are seven parts of the U.S. that we're working intensively with. Florida is one of those, to make sure that when that first case is identified, we're able collectively to spring to action and prevent that person from infecting another mosquito.
Mark, did you have something you want to add?
Yeah, one important point, which is a good point, as far as the U.S. is concerned, one of the reasons why we're not prone to explosive epidemics of dengue, chikungunya, and now Zika, is that we live a different lifestyle than Puerto Rico, the rest of the Caribbean, South America. We live in screened and air-conditioned houses. And the mosquito that transmits the disease, Aedes aegypti, the yellow fever mosquito, it lives outdoors in our areas. When you go down to the Caribbean or Puerto Rico, this mosquito lives indoors with people. They're exposed 24 hours a day. So there is a big difference there, and that's why we haven't seen, even though we have a lot of the mosquitoes.
You're saying that because their houses aren't air-conditioned and screened? Is that the reason why
you're
saying?
Yes, in Florida and the rest of the U.S., whereas even the wealthy in the Caribbean live in open houses, where they're exposed 24 hours a day to this mosquito that likes to live inside a house if it can. It doesn't here, but it will down there.
Any, Matt?
One other thing about the species of mosquito he's talking about, and one of the things that I was mentioning about like public awareness, it has to do with their particular biology or their behavior, which is they don't breed in lakes, ponds, ditches, things like that. They specifically breed in close association to man in very small containers. That's just a kind of a catch-all phrase we in mosquito management use to refer to them as, is container breeding mosquitoes, because they'll be found in the little wrinkles on tarps, bromeliads, which people love to grow because they're easy to grow, but a lot of them hold water at the base of the leaves. Even just a bottle cap full of water can breed these species of mosquitoes, and that's why it's really important that people understand that, because I would probably say greater than 80% of the service requests that my staff goes to, especially in urban areas, the people are creating their own problem because they're not checking their yard, they're not actually looking for that. And anytime you're gonna have disease transmission, you gotta have three things. You have to have a disease there, you have to have a susceptible population, and you have to have some means of transmission, which, you know, in this case would be the mosquito. So We do spray, much like Mark Latham's district does, but like he said, that's really a last resort. We prefer to control them in the larval state. And with these, since they have such short flight ranges and such cryptic, well-known breeding sites, it's a lot easier to attack it from that area and just eliminate the breeding sites. It's part of the whole the dump and cover message that the health department puts out.
Anything else, Don?
So one of the areas that may be worthy of exploring is under the Citizen Corps. We have the
Under the what?
Under Citizens Corps,
okay.
Which is part of that national program for getting people to take ownership and start helping themselves. We have what's called CERT, Community Emergency Response Teams. In Manatee County, there's actually 16 of them, and they're in various areas. But we teach them first aid. We teach them how to use a fire extinguisher. We teach them how to do search and rescue during major events. But it's really not an all-hazard program. From Mark's point, teaching them how to police their grounds, things to look for from a all-hazard perspective, such as emptying containers, things of that nature, may be worth taking a look at and seeing if we can't just expand the current curriculum.
All righty. Well, let me just say I've got to catch a plane here in a little bit, get back up to Washington, but I do want to thank the Admiral and thank the panelists and thank the public. I am committed to making sure you get the resources, Admiral, your organization. In fact, we have a meeting that I chair, co-chair. All Democrats and Republicans, we have the third largest delegation in the country, congressional delegation, and we're going to be talking about funding. We're going to be talking about exactly where a lot of this is at. So I appreciate him coming from Atlanta. Let's give him a round of applause. Appreciate what he does. And again, just thank all the panelists, and then I'm sure the panelists, if anybody has any questions, will be around. Thank you, and have a great day.